Let's take a look at this box right here. It is resting on a table. Now, this box has got several faces. It has got six faces, but we are going to concentrate, or we are going to concern ourselves with three of the faces. We have face A, we have face B, and we have face C right there. Now, if you look at face A, the surface area of face A is slightly bigger than the surface area of face B, and then the surface area of face C is the smallest. Now, each of these faces can get into contact with the table. For example, face A, if I want it to be in contact with the table, I simply put it in contact. Face C, if I want it to be in contact with the table, I'll simply do that, and so forth, and so with face B. Now, when these three faces are in contact with this table, because this thing has a weight, it's going to exert pressure on this table. But remember, we said that in our previous video that pressure is going to be equivalent to force over area. So it means if the pressure is going to be equivalent to force over area, it means that the amount of pressure that is going to be exerted by all these faces when they come into contact with this table is going to be different, because the surface areas are different. The area here is bigger than the area here. So it means when those three get into contact with this table, don't expect the pressure to be the same. But the weight of this thing will still be the same. But because the surface areas that are in contact with this table are different, that is going to make the pressure exerted onto this table to be different. In this video, we are going to explore, or we are going to investigate, how the surface area of contact affects the pressure in solids. This is Kisembo Academy, and thanks for tuning in. We are going to investigate this using a worked example. We have a question. In our question, they are telling us that the weight of this cuboid is 60 newtons. Find the pressure exerted by the faces A, B, and C. So you're going to find the pressure exerted by face A, face B, and face C. Then we shall compare the pressures exerted and come to a conclusion. So we begin our calculation with finding the pressure on face A. If face A gets into contact with the table, what is the pressure that it will exert? So pressure is going to give us force over area. Now for face A, the force, which is the same as the weight, is 60 newtons. So it's going to be 60 newtons, divide that by the surface area. Now the surface area of face A has dimensions of 0.2 times 0.1. So the surface area here is going to be 0.2 times 0.1, this is meters squared. And the answer is going to be, it's going to be 60 newtons, divide that by 0.02. And definitely our answer here will be 3000 newtons per meter squared. That is the pressure of A. Let's go on to pressure of face B. The pressure of face B is going to be equal to force over area, and that is going to be equal to the force, which is still the same, which is 60 newtons, which is the weight, divide that by the area. Now the dimensions of area of B, the area of this face is 0.2 times 0.05. So this is going to become 60, divide that by 0.2 times 0.05 gives us 0.01. This is newtons, this is meters squared, and we end up with our answer being 6000 newtons per meter squared. Then we have face C. Now the pressure for face C, pressure on face C is going to be equal to force over area. We know that our force is still going to be the same. The thing is 60 newtons. So it's 60 newtons, divide that by the surface area. Now if you look at the dimensions of C, it is 0.1 times 0.05. And 0.1 times 0.05, this is supposed to be meters squared. So it's going to give us 60, divide that by 0.1 times 0.05. 0.05 is going to give us 0.005. And we shall get the pressure there being 12,000 newtons. Newtons per meter squared. This is the pressure of A. This is the pressure of B. And this is the pressure of experienced on face C. Now, you realize that we are still having the same box or the same cuboid. It is having the same weight, which is 60 newtons. But when you make this thing lie on the surface of the table, on these three different faces of A, B, and C, you realize that the pressures being exerted are different. Now, let's try and compare these pressures that are being exerted on this table. We try and relate them with the area. If you look at the area of A, the area of face A, remember we got it as 0.02. The surface area of box B, we got it as 0.01. And the surface area of C, the area of the face is 0.005. If you look at the surface areas, you realize that surface area of A is the biggest and the surface area of C is the smallest. But then when you look at the pressure, you find that the biggest pressure was experienced on surface of C and the smallest pressure was experienced when surface A was in contact with the table. So what conclusion does this bring us to? This brings us to the conclusion that the smaller the surface area of contact between the box and the table, the bigger the pressure will be. And the bigger the surface area of contact, then the smaller the pressure will be. So this brings us to the conclusion that our pressure in solid is dependent on area in such a way that the smaller the area, the higher the pressure. As simple as that. This explains why when I get a needle and I prick myself, I will feel more pain if I use the sharp end than when I use the blunt end. Let's use this pen. It has got the sharp end and the blunt end. If I got this sharp end and I pricked myself, ouch, I'll feel more pain. But if I use this blunt end and I try and prick myself, I can even do this. But I can't afford to do that on this side because it's sharp. I'll feel more pain. This is because the surface area of contact here, between the surface area of contact between this pen and my skin is small. So because the surface area is small, I will experience a higher pressure. And that higher pressure will bring about more pain. Yet this way, the surface area of contact between this and here, it is big. So the bigger the surface area of contact, the lower the pressure, and so that's why I feel less pain. It is the same explanation with tractors. If you've been to Africa and you know that some roads are muddy, some roads are impassable, or even in a garden. But you find that if a small car is to come and pass by in a very muddy area or in a slippery zone, it will get stuck in the mud so easily. But then if a tractor came around and it will just hover over the mud and drive through very smoothly. Now, why is that? Why is it that a tractor, which is very heavy, can easily hover over a muddy place? But then a small car whose weight is less will get into the in the mud and get stuck. The principle is just this. If you look at the tires of a car, they are very small. And so because they are very small, when they get into the mud, they exert a very high pressure. And when they exert the very high pressure, they get into the mud and they get stuck there. So the high pressure that this small the small surface area of these tires is exerting onto the mud gets the car stuck. But if you look at this tractor, however big it is, but because it is having a very wide surface area beneath its tires, because it means that those tires are going to exert a reasonably low pressure onto the mud, and as a result, because of this low pressure that is being exerted onto the mud, the tractor will easily hover over the mud. We can try that question in right in front of our screen. This brings us to the end of this video. Thanks for watching. For more of these videos, simply subscribe and please remember to share this video. For Kisembo Academy, this is Arnold Ranga Koromia.